I have two questions for you today. Have you heard about Jesus? And what have you heard about Jesus? Do you ever go through times where the Lord reveals himself in fresh ways? I'm in that period right now. In the last 6 months to a year, the Lord has been, through things I've been reading and people I've been hearing speak about him, has brought fresh revelation to me, and there is nothing like it. So today I want to talk to you about, are you hearing about Jesus? You know, what we hear affects us greatly, because what we hear will then determine what we do and what our response might be. And unfortunately, in the last, I don't know how long it's been, and I even participated in this, we have turned the gospel from being about Jesus Christ and all that he's done and all that he will do, and we've turned it into an introspective that he can't unless we've got to measure up, and it's all about us, not about him. And it's a deceitful, it's a sly way for us to become antichrist. Yes, hear me, antichrist. Because when we make it about us, about what we've done, how big our faith is or our lack of faith, it becomes all about us. But today we're going to talk about Jesus and all that he's done, and those that heard about him, what responses that it caused them to have. The first story I want to bring you is about the woman with the issue of blood. And in Mark chapter 5, we have this story about the woman with the issue of blood, and it said that she had the issue for about 12 years, and that she had spent her livelihood on doctor after doctor, and she had not gotten any better. But the word says in verse 27 of Mark chapter 5, when she had heard about Jesus, so she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his robe. For she thought to herself, if I can touch his robe, just touch his robe, I will be healed. Immediately the bleeding stopped, and she could feel in her body that she had been healed of her terrible condition. Then Jesus realized that someone had touched her and that healing power had gone out from him. So he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my robe? His disciples said to him, look at this crowd pressing around you. How can you ask who touched me? But he kept on looking around to see who had done it. Then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell on her knees in front of him and told him what she had done. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Your suffering is over. She heard about Jesus. She heard about the miracles that he was doing. How great was her hearing? Her hearing was so great that she was able to overcome her breaking the law. It was against the law for her to be in public with her blood issue. Against the law. But what she heard about Jesus caused her to go against knowing that she was a sinner, caused her to go against knowing that the synagogue could come against her, went against her embarrassment of possibly having some kind of blood issue in public, went against her being weak, because she said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I will be well. She heard about Jesus. But what she heard about Jesus caused it to be greater than what she was facing in her own life, caused him to be greater than what she thought the repercussions might be. She didn't care. She was desperate to be healed. And what she heard about Jesus caused her to come against all those things and overlook them, overrule them, because her desire to get to Jesus was greater than the condemnation she was feeling or knew that she was going to come against. What are you hearing about Jesus? Do you know that Jesus loves you? Do you know that while you were yet a sinner, Christ died for you? We've turned it around, and we've made it, if you have enough faith, and then we've had faith in our faith, and we've almost made faith a god and an idol, that it's before him. But it's not our faith, it's the object of our faith. Have we put our faith in him? Let's read another story out of the Old Testament about Rahab. And this is in Joshua chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. I know, Rahab's talking to the spies, I know the Lord has given you this land, she told them. We are all afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror, for we have heard how the Lord made a dry path for you through the Red Sea when you left Egypt. And we know what you did to Sihon and Og, the two Amorite kings east of the Jordan River, whose people you completely destroyed. No wonder our hearts have melted in fear. No one has the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. Whatever the town of Jericho had heard, it caused most of them to be in fear, that their hearts were melting. But when the spies came to Rahab, she was a prostitute, and they came to her and she hid them. What she heard about God caused her to want to be a part of them. I don't want to be on the destruction side. I want to be with you, because what I've heard about you, what I've heard about your God, I want to be a part of it. She didn't consider her livelihood. She didn't consider her station in life. She heard how great God was, and she wanted to be a part of that. What are you hearing about Jesus? Are you hearing that he's looking and inspecting you, looking for any minute thing that you might have sinned? Well, let me just tell you, you have. Let's just settle that right now. But God is greater. Jesus is greater. Since I begin to see the greatness of my Lord and see all the things that he's done, I'm reading the scriptures differently. You know, when I used to read the Old Testament, I would read about all the bad things that they had done and how God had to judge them and blah, blah, blah. And yes, the Bible does say that. But now I'm reading it differently, that in spite of the fact that they sinned, in spite of the fact that they had done this or that, God still moved. God still called them. Let's go to Moses. Moses was a murderer. Moses ran away in fear, and he left and ran into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 years, the word says. But one day, God came to him in the burning bush. And despite the fact that he was a murderer, God came to him. And when Moses talked with him, Moses followed him. David was a murderer. He was an adulterer. But God was greater. Saul, who was murdering Christians, who became Paul when his name was changed, because he met Jesus. What he was, what he had done, did not stop what God was wanting to do in his life and through him. No matter where you are, no matter what you're facing, no matter what you may have done, Jesus is greater. He is full of mercy and compassion. He is gracious. And he brings us and he draws us to himself. You know, there is a teaching that sin separates us from God. And while that is true in the sense of we must have a Savior, sin never stopped God. Because if it had, all of us are cooked. Bad choice of words, I suppose. But all of us are in trouble. But God is greater. He's not waiting on us. It tells us that even in Revelation, it says that Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. So even before Adam was created, the provision was already made for a Savior, because God knew we were going to need it. God is faithful. Romans 5 and I believe 8 says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ, or God, wasn't waiting for a Savior, for people to be begging for forgiveness and repenting and doing all those things. It was already in the making before our hearts were turned toward God. He already had gone before us. Let me tell you another story about Peter. And the story tells us in the New Testament, and we are in Matthew chapter 14, and Jesus is walking across the water, and the disciples saw him, and they thought it was a ghost, so they were afraid. But Jesus spoke to them, and he called to them and said, "Don't be afraid. Take courage. I am here." Then Peter called him and said, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water." Peter heard Jesus say, "Yes, come." So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt me?" Jesus, how wonderful he is. Jesus, all that he has, all that he encompasses. The law and the devil want us to look circumspectly and fall short. And I'm going to tell you, we're always going to fall short. But he is the one that brings the balance. He is the one that makes up for everything that we've ever done. Should we sin? Of course not. But that doesn't stop God from working in us. If it does, then we can't even come to receive a Savior because I'm a sinner. But God has made provision with the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he said, "It is finished," he meant it was finished. Everything. He had dotted every I. He had crossed every T. He had done everything to make sure everything was taken care of. Everything was taken care of. It went back to Adam, the first man ever created. And it goes forward to the last man that will ever be born on the face of the earth. A man or woman born on the face of the earth, his blood is the sacrifice that covers it all. We have one more story I want to talk about. We have the story of the people in Jesus' hometown. And the word says that Jesus returned to Nazareth. We're in Matthew chapter 13, his hometown. And when he taught there in the synagogue, everyone was amazed and said, "Where does he get his wisdom and the power to do miracles?" Then they scoffed. In one moment, they're talking about how wise he is. Where does he get this wisdom? And then they're even seeing with his eyes the miracles that he does. But then they said, "He's just the carpenter's son. And we know Mary, his mother, and his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. All his sisters live right here among us. Where did he learn all these things?" And they were deeply offended, and listen to this, refused to believe in him. Then Jesus told them, "A prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown and among his own family. And so he did only a few miracles there because of their unbelief." What were they hearing about Jesus? They heard and they saw, but because of who he was, because they knew him in the natural, they could not accept his godhood, even though they saw, even though they heard the wisdom. What are you hearing and what are you seeing? The enemy wants to make our circumstances bigger, like Peter. He got out in the water. They were afraid because they thought he was a ghost. Jesus spoke words of comfort and peace. So when he heard that, he said, "Jesus, if it's you, bid me to come." And he heard Jesus say, "Come." Bam, Peter's out at the side of the boat and on that water. And all of a sudden, he realizes the waves. Wasn't any different. Jesus was still there. He was still standing on top of the waves. You know, it's kind of telling yourself you can't do something you're doing. And that's what he was doing. He was standing on the waves, but all of a sudden, when he began to see the waves, his faith wobbled and he doubted. But you know what? Jesus said, oh, your faith is weak. But then he reached over and took him up. It didn't stop Jesus from working on his behalf. Jesus loves us. We've got to understand Jesus loves us. He is not holding our weaknesses against us. He wants us to be strengthened, but he also recognized we cannot be strengthened without him. He is so great and wonderful. So today, what are you hearing? Do you know that our circumstances speak to us? Our circumstances tell us, oh, you know what? This has been going on so long, it'll never change. The diagnosis from the doctor might be so bad that I can't believe that Jesus could heal me or is greater. What a man has told me that I can't believe that Jesus is greater. My bills may be speaking to me. They speak to you. If you haven't recognized that, you need to know that. They speak to you. And we need to hear about Jesus. We need to hear how much he cares for us. We need to hear about the wonderful graciousness of our Lord and Savior, who is full of mercy and grace. And I read a scripture yesterday. I want to read this. This was so good because I want to tell you, you would have never heard me say, because I believe confession is important, because out of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so therefore, you could get on people for what they're speaking, but it just tells you what's really in their heart. Like Peter, for example, when Jesus said to him, before the cock crows, twice, you're going to deny me three times, before three times, deny me twice. I don't remember. Sorry, I didn't read that before this. It just came to me. And even though Jesus warned him of that, Peter did that. Why? Because it was in his heart. So what we need to do, yes, change what we say, but we need to work more on changing what's in our heart. What are we hearing? That our heart is full to overflowing of who Jesus is, what Jesus has done, and what Jesus will do. This will make you an evangelist, because we can go anywhere. We can go to people that don't know, that haven't been in church in years, maybe never. We can go to people that prostitutes on the street. We could go to people that are laying on sick bed that have AIDS or whatever, and we could say, oh, you're sick because of this reason or that. Who cares? Jesus is greater. He loves us. He loves us. He loves us. He's not waiting for us to have everything right to work in our life. And it's so easy to get to that point, well, I must not have enough faith. And then it becomes all about me. I want you to hear about Jesus today, how great he is, how wonderful he is. So I want to read to you out of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And it's in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3. Again, I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. The King James and New King James says something like, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. But this is what the New Living Translation says. God blesses those who are poor and realize their need for him. We need him, and he's everything. So that God does not hold it against us that we fall short. He doesn't hold it against us. We need to be in a position to receive from him. Because if I think I don't need him, then he doesn't show up. Not because he doesn't want to, but if I'm going to do it all, he'll say, well, then you do it all. But if I come to a place and say, God, I can't do this, I need you, then he shows up. Because he wants us to know that we need him desperately. So what are you hearing about Jesus? What have you heard about Jesus? You cannot know enough about him. You cannot think that he's great enough, because he's greater than anything that we have going on in our lives. And he wants to show up again and again and again to show us how wonderful he is and what he wants to do for us, so that we are not carrying the burdens, but that we are set free because of what he has done. So I'm going to ask you the same questions that I asked you at the beginning. Have you heard about Jesus? And what have you heard about Jesus? Let him reveal himself to you today. God bless you.